All right, today we're going to go over a basic introduction of what exercise physiology is. So first we're going to go over some key definitions. Exercise physiology is the study of how the body's functions are altered when exposed to exercise, which is a challenge to homeostasis. Essentially what this means is that exercise forces your body to go into a state that it's uncomfortable with, and therefore exercise forces your body to adapt to this challenge to homeostasis. This is what's believed to make exercise so beneficial for people, because your body adapts and becomes better and more efficient. Sports physiology, on the other hand, is the application of the concepts of exercise physiology for the purpose of enhancing sports performance. So now we have two other important concepts. We have acute exercise and chronic exercise. Acute exercise is looking at a single individual bout of exercise. So if I went out and went for a 30-minute bike ride, what would the effects be? Meanwhile, chronic exercise would be if I went out and trained for 5 days a week, 30 minutes at 60 to 70% of my aerobic heart rate, and to see what would be the change from the beginning of my training to the end of a longer period of chronic exercise training. In short, acute and chronic exercise frames what we're looking at. So we're also going to go over some of the key players in the history and development of exercise physiology. The Harvard Fatigue Laboratory was the most impactful lab in the field of exercise physiology research, at least in the beginning. It was founded by biochemist L.J. Henderson in 1927 and was directed by D.B. Dill until closure in 1947. Another extremely important figure in the field of exercise physiology is A.V. Hill, who was the only exercise physiologist to be awarded the Nobel Prize. His area of study and contributions include figuring out anaerobic versus aerobic exercise, VO2 max, heat production from nerves, the series elastic component for muscles, and then force velocity equation for muscles. The last three findings really do have a lot more to do with biomechanics and exercise physiology, but overall he was a very key player in the field of exercise physiology. Next, we will go over some of the important research tools used in exercise physiology research. So an ergometer is an exercise device that allows intensity of exercise to be controlled and measured. This can include common devices such as a treadmill, a cycle ergometer, or even an exercise flume for measuring swimmers in a pool. However, treadmills and cycle ergometers are predominantly used for exercise physiology research, both of which have their pros and cons. Treadmills, for example, the pros are walking is natural. Most people can achieve peak performance on a treadmill. And the cons of a treadmill are that they are more expensive and they require electricity and are not portable. The pros of a cycle ergometer are that it is independent of body weight, which is very important if you are measuring individuals with different body weights. However, the cons of a cycle ergometer are that if you're not used to using a cycle ergometer or biking, your leg muscles may fatigue first before your aerobic capacity is reached. So finally, we're going to talk about something very important to exercise physiology, which is research design. So cross-sectional research design is when you're looking at a specific population tested at one specific time, and you're looking at the difference between groups. Meanwhile, a longitudinal study is when you're using the same subjects and testing them periodically to measure changes over time. So an example of a cross-sectional study might be if you wanted to see how VO2 max affects race performance, and you took a giant group of individuals, both fit and non-fit, and tested all of them, and just tried to find the association between VO2 max and speed on, say, a 5K test. Meanwhile, the longitudinal version of this study would be if you recruited a certain number of non-runners and then measured VO2 max at the beginning at baseline and then tried to improve that VO2 max with training and then compared the difference in their performance on, say, a 5K race at baseline and then at the end and saw how it was related to changes in VO2 max and fitness. An important thing to note with cross-sectional studies is that you cannot determine causation, only association. While longitudinal studies may allow for the inference of causation. Finally, these are just a few aspects in research considerations. For example, Exercise usually elicits a dose response, which means the effects of the response are based on the amount of a treatment. Then you have diurnal volation, which is a fluctuation that occurs during 24-hour day. So if you test someone in the morning versus testing them at night, they're going to have different aspects and elicit different responses to exercise and other aspects. Finally, for women, you have to keep in mind the menstrual cycle, which is a 28-day cycle for women that affects hormones. This is important because women who are undergoing exercise will respond differently in many cases, depending on where in the menstrual cycle they are. So these are all just some considerations. There are many, many more to keep in mind, but these are considerations for when you are trying to maybe design an exercise physiology study or when you're reading about exercise physiology studies that others have conducted. So this was just a very brief view of exercise physiology and exercise science. If you have any questions, please leave a comment down below. I also know I haven't posted in a while, but I'm going to try to get on top of things now that the school semester is starting to wean down and I have a bit more time. Just to get an idea of where I'm at, I'm actually applying to a neuroscience-related PhD program. So if you're interested in that whole application process for getting a higher education degree in PhD schools, please leave a comment down below. If you have any questions, feel free to ask in the comments. Bye.